fact, geology fans. Metamorphic rocks form from precursor rocks by being subjected to new regimes of temperature and pressure. Pressure increases at about 1 pound per square inch per foot, or almost 1 bar per 4.5 meters. The deeper into the Earth's crust we go, determined by the formula rho gh, where rho is the average density of overlying rock, g is the gravitational acceleration, and h is depth. We call this pressure the lithostatic pressure on the rock, which acts equally on all faces of the rock volume, which we saw previously was a reasonable assumption, as deviatoric stress can't build up very much before the rock yields and deforms, thus equalizing the stress differences. Lithostatic pressure at a given depth is primarily dependent on the density of overlying rock, as g doesn't vary as much. As a general guide, the pressure at 10 kilometers depth in the crust ranges from 2.6 kilobars below lower density rocks that might be found in continents, and can be up to about 3.2 kilobars at 10 kilometers below higher density rocks, such as those making up ocean crust. But there are exceptions to these comments on pressure. Compressive deviatoric stress doesn't usually build up much, but in some tectonic cases, it can cause overpressuring, allowing higher pressure minerals to form than would be predicted purely from the lithostatic pressure. The other exception is that fluids within the rock may not obey lithostatic pressure. In the extreme case of a rock with no fluids present, a dry rock, the fluid pressure isn't. That is, fluid pressure equals zero, and the lithostatic pressure passes directly across mineral grain boundaries. But add a fluid, and it will exert a pressure outward on the grain boundaries that reduces the effective pressure felt at those grains. The dry rock is a stronger rock with less chance of failure than a wet rock with its increased fluid pore pressure and reduced effective pressure across the grain faces. As a rock with water in the pore spaces gets buried, the water may not be able to escape and the fluid pressure can build up, sometimes approaching lithostatic pressure. But many minerals at the surface contain water and carbon dioxide, the most common fluids, with methane or nitrogen being less common. As these minerals are buried and heated, such volatile fluids are driven off from the new mineral species forming, and this can cause fluid pore pressure to get up to, and in some cases even exceed, lithostatic pressure. If the fluid pressure gets high enough over lithostatic pressure to exceed the rock's resistance to being ripped apart, known as the tensile strength of the rock, which is a remarkably low value for most rocks, the rock will blow apart in what is known as hydraulic fracturing, which you may be familiar with as a principle used to extract hydrocarbons from tightly bound rocks in a process most call fracking, short for hydraulic fracturing. But increased temperature is the main cause of driving off these pore pressure increasing fluids, and in fact, temperature is the main cause of the metamorphic changes we will see, with pressure being rather secondary. We noted that the rise in temperature with depth in the Earth's crust is called the geothermal gradient, and though it is usually around 25 degrees Celsius per kilometer of depth, it often ranges 15 to 30 degrees Celsius per kilometer, and can take on extremes of 5 to 60 degrees Celsius per kilometer. The range of values speaks of a range of environments we call tectonic environments that are well covered in such a diagram as this, with a mid-ocean ridge making mostly basaltic ocean floor, which then subducts below a continent making an arc of volcanoes near the subduction zone, and a stable back arc continental basin. We can think of movement of heat as energy flow, which is physically measured in watts per square meter. If we plot the amount of heat flowing from the hot interior out of the surface of the Earth of these tectonic environments, we see the mid-ocean ridges have the highest heat flow, which drops off from the ridge towards the subduction zone, where it reaches a minimum, but picks up quickly at the continental volcanic arcs, though not as high as the ocean ridges. And this heat flow then drops off gradually in the continent behind the volcanic arc known as the back arc basin. The reason for these values is straightforward. There are basaltic volcanoes at the mid-ocean ridges delivering magma directly from the hot mantle below. If we start near 15 degrees Celsius, the average surface temperature, we see that the temperature rises rapidly below a mid-ocean ridge, giving us one of the extremes in geothermal gradients, with the 30 to 60 degrees Celsius per kilometer at shallower depths, but then leveling off to the lower end of geothermal gradients at depth. As ocean floor moves away from the mid-ocean ridges in a conveyor belt-like manner, the igneous slab cools, and the shallow geothermal gradient decreases until the most common geothermal gradient on Earth is attained at about 25 degrees Celsius per kilometer, but it begins to even out below about 100 kilometers in the mantle and becomes indistinguishable from mid-ocean ridge geothermal gradient below this depth. Should a hot spot rise below the ocean crust, as in the case with the Hawaiian Islands, we should see a geothermal gradient somewhat between that of the mid-ocean ridge and the stable ocean crust, again stabilizing out below about 100 kilometers down in the mantle. This makes sense as the hot spot convects hotter material closer to the surface. A subduction zone is quite the opposite, taking colder oceanic crust down into the hotter interior. The lowest geothermal gradients are found in these subduction zones, and the faster the slab is subducting, the lower the geothermal gradient near the surface. The temperature changes slowly enough with depth here that it can take up to 150 kilometers depth before the geothermal gradient begins to meld into that of the other environments. The hottest rocks at the surface correlate with the steepest shallow geothermal gradients and also have the least dense rocks and thus the lower lithostatic pressure at any given depth. Besides the metamorphic effects these variations in pressure and temperature regimes produce, we also see processes such as oil and gas formation being determined by such gradients in the Earth. We saw with the igneous rocks that minerals melt at varying temperatures depending on pressure and presence or absence of fluids. We can plot a line called the solidus, which indicates the temperatures at which common minerals will melt at various depths. Compare it to the geothermal gradient and see why we tend to get volcanics where we do, as we see the temperature in the geothermal gradient exceeding the solidus near the surface at these places of volcanism. That's how we make magma and the igneous rocks they produce, but this episode is about metamorphic rocks. If a rock is buried or subducted, but we don't cross the solidus line, we will stay in the solid state and can take the minerals that were previously comfortable nearer the surface and cause them to change physically and chemically, the very bread and butter and meat of metamorphic rocks. Such changes are systematic enough, not random, that we can look at a metamorphic rock and often tell what kind of rock it originally was, or at least we can tell what extremes of temperature and pressure the rock was subjected to. The most indicative minerals of temperature and pressure are called index minerals, and help us give a first broad brushstroke of metamorphic rocks in this chart of temperature versus pressure, with broad fields mapped out by the various index minerals into what we call metamorphic facies. We met this chart before in our episode on metamorphic silicate minerals, and a review of that episode will aid on our exploration of metamorphic rocks. In future episodes, we will follow various common rock types down into the metamorphic facies levels and see what rocks result. But with all this talk of chemical changes in the solid state, first off, we're going to have to take a deeper exploration into the chemistry and techniques used to investigate metamorphic mineral changes. So come back for that next time here on Earth Explorations.